All right, well, it's been a week since we weaned Trapper John, and in that week he's gotten much, much friendlier, braver, and outgoing. So we haven't worked with him in the trailer lately because it's getting to be our busy time of the year, and he kind of acted like he wanted to go do something. So we figured we'd see how he is about the trailer after we worked him. Oh, come on, Trap. Good boy. Don't get any better than that. Yeah. Well, some grain in here. What's that? Well, he knows what grain bucket is. Yeah, well, should you get out of the trailer? He's, Mama's standing right there too, Lee is. So he still talks to her and stuff, but he's definitely becoming one of the boys. He hangs out with his big brother, Rush, pretty much all the time. So I shouldn't really be letting him walk ahead of me like that, but it was good for a camera shot. So he's not scared of the lamb, little beloved lamb. What you got? So he's doing good. I might let him pick out here, and it's kind of cold and windy, so might get a curry and just brush him a little bit real quick, whatnot. I'm going to put shoes on Luke here this afternoon. I won't bring you guys along for... Come on. I won't bring you guys along for all of that, but I'll bring you along for at least 1 foot. That way, those of you that have never seen the process of putting a set of shoes on a horse, you can see how I do it. I'm not a farrier by any means, and a lot of what I know is self-taught. So I probably do things a little bit different, but my horses are sound and their shoes stay on for the most part. Everybody loses one once in a while. So anyways, I'll see you guys once I get Luke over there. Let's see Mama real quick here. How's that for a baby belly? Yeah, you're pretty wide, ain't ya? Yeah. He's right here. She still loves him. Here in a couple weeks, I'll probably take him to a set of corrals that's at a different, totally different place than this. That way they can't see or hear each other. And that'll kind of get it to where they quit being, you know, so buddy sour towards each other. Even though it's really good that... Step up, Trevor. Even though it's really good that she likes her colts like that, or her foals rather, but he can go grow up. Anyways, I'll see you when I got Luke on the shoeing pad. All right, so it's really kind of simple. I don't normally dump all my tools out of my bag right away, but I did just so you guys could see what's what. Shoeing shafts are pretty straightforward. They're leather right there. Canvas, they got one snap that'll... It's a thin tie on them, so if it gets caught, it'll break. Got some pockets on them. They got a little magnet. Nothing too crazy. First thing I do is I take my hoof knife, which is this, and my clinch cutter slash Pritchell, whichever you want to use, and I'll just clean his foot out just to get an idea wherever you need to be to get the shot. Go for it. Just to get an idea how long his feet really are. So he's going to be pretty long this time, I think. So Not really what that tool's made for, but it works pretty good. So once I get his foot cleaned out there, I'll take the end of my hoof knife. It's got a curve on it. And I'll run that kind of just around the inside of his foot. And the white flaky stuff that's coming out easy is just dead hoof material, just like excess on your fingernails. So I'll get to that point. I'll give him his foot back a minute. Put my hoof knife in my shaft here, and I'll grab my shoeing hammer. This is a 7-ounce shoeing hammer. They come in different weights and shapes, and this is the one I've gotten that works for me. So pick his foot up again here. Now this edge is what's called the clinch cutter. It's not that sharp or anything, but I'll take and I'll put them just under the clinches, and all I'm doing is unfolding them so the shoe will pull out when we get it with the pullers. Another way you can do this step is to just take the smooth side of a hoof rasp and rasp the clinches off. It doesn't matter, it doesn't make a difference. It's just all in what you'd like to do. Okay, next I've got pullers. They hinge, they've got one flat side and then one thin side. That's not really an edge or a blade per se. It's just to get underneath the shoe. Take and work it. You gotta have it the right way though. It gets underneath the shoe like that, and I pry a little bit and work back and forth on either side. That way I don't put a whole bunch of torque straight into his hock and all that all at once. I'll spin him around, kind of. There's probably a right way and a wrong way to use these. I don't know it. Like I said earlier, I'm self-taught on most of this. I figured out what worked and what didn't, and that's how I do stuff. Okay, get the old shoe out. That's how his foot would look without it. Now this shoe is probably reusable. They have a new shoe compared to an old shoe. This groove here is one thing you look at when you determine if a shoe is reusable or not. If that shoe's wore down and that groove's like halfway gone or more, you can just discard the shoe. That groove is what helps hold the nail in and protect the nail heads from wearing off as the horse walks. Another thing I like to look at is I like to see how even the shoe's wearing. If one's wearing a little bit crooked, say I set it crooked a little bit on accident or something like that, well, you don't want to walk around in crooked shoes, so you wouldn't put crooked shoes on a horse. Just for simplicity for the video here, I'm going to put new shoes on him. All you got to do to get the old shoes ready to put on him is take the old nails out and clean all the packed dirt and manure out of that groove. Make sure it's flat and you're good to go. Next thing I'll do is I'll take my nippers. These are just the horse's version of fingernail trimmers. I'll pick his foot up again here. Okay, I'm gonna start by cleaning out back there on either side. I'll dig out all this stuff that'll come out really easy here for me. I probably don't take my horses as short as a lot of real farriers do, and that's just how it is, I guess. Probably because years ago I tried to get and make a point of taking hoofs down real short and taking the frog out and cleaning them up and really making them pretty like a show farrier does. And all that happened is they got lame on the rocks. So if I don't have to take any of their frog out, I don't. That frog is what pumps the blood through the foot as they walk. So I'll leave it. Oh, I'm just still scraping the sole of his foot here. You can see, right, move a little bit of this. The difference between the flaky, dry looking stuff, which is up here, if the camera will focus, there it goes. That flaky, dry stuff is the dead stuff. And then the stuff that looks like a healthy fingernail is healthy hoof. I don't take any further down than that. I'm sure that a real farrier probably would. But I make sure and get all the way down to the sole, all the way around. Take a little bit more out of here. Okay, and that gives me a line to nip. I'll start in the front and I'll work around either side. When you get to about this part of the foot, you need to kind of pay attention because you will get, without trying, you will get too deep, and then it makes it really hard to get the foot flat to put the shoe on. Okay, I like to break that off there just so it'll move a little bit. Trim him around. That's just my daughter making some noise, saying hi to you guys. Okay, so that foot's trimmed. Needs a little bit off of this back heel here yet. Okay, I'm gonna take the camera for just a second here. Now I will look down the hoof at this angle and make sure that it's not canted either way. That's the number one thing. This one looks pretty good. And then you can see it's got, so it is a little low here, like I said, and a little long in that toe. So now I'll take my rasp and I'll get rid of that high spot. I have one of the nails must have broke off. So I'll just grab that with my old set of nippers and pull that out before I go to working on the rasp, or working on the hoof with the rasp. So that's all it was. Now, being a brand new shoe, it's gonna be flat. You see right now, if I were to just tack it on him right now, there's a whole bunch of daylight in off of this side here. That's gonna equal to a missing shoe in a little bit. So I'll take the rasp, I'll knock his toe down. See a little bit of red there, right there. That's from a old stone bruise or something. It's not tender to him or anything like that. Some people get nervous. That's him snorting. That's Luke snorting, by the way. Okay, we'll check it again here. It's quite a bit better. Take a little bit off of each heel. Okay. That shoe sits nice and flat. It doesn't want to rock. There's not a big gap there. Now you can see that it doesn't quite fit his foot just exactly right. It needs to be made to be a little bit, what are you snorting at? Made to be just a hair wider. Are you good? Anyways, it needs to be made just a hair wider. That's pretty easy to do. We got a little tiny shoe and anvil. This is only a 35 pound. Real farriers, you'll see, like on the back of their trucks, they got big anvils mounted, and you probably can do a lot more in a big anvil than you can one of these little guys. But for me, just doing my own horses, little guy works just fine. To get that shoe wider, I'm gonna set it right there. About two hits is all it needs. Your anvil's a flat surface. Set your shoe down. Make sure it don't rock. If it does, you can just flatten them out again. Real farriers have a forge and they hot shoe and do all sorts of cool fancy stuff that I don't do. Real farriers probably also do a lot better job than I do. So that fits him a lot better now. You can see the heels line up pretty good. Got a little bit of overhang on the toe right up here. That's okay, that'll trim off once we get the shoe put on. It's got a little bit of a rock to it though, I just noticed. So I'm gonna try and knock down a little bit right here. Yeah, now it sits smooth. Okay, we're almost ready to tack this shoe on. One thing I do like to do with all shoes, whether you shape them or not, is when they're made, the holes that the nails go in, sometimes they have like a little bit of cast flashing or something like that, and it can be enough to where it'll make a nail tight when you're setting your nails. So I will just take the Pritchell side of my clinch cutter, put them in the back side here, and just give it a tap. You can see the difference in that number one nail versus the one next to it, just from a little tap like that. All that allows me to do is just be able to set the nail better. Sometimes I run three nails, sometimes I run four. And actually, I know some of the country that we're gonna be in, north of Reno here next week, and it can be pretty rocky. So I'm gonna run four. You know, if I didn't see any rocky country in my near future, if I expected just to be inside on the hay fields or something, then I'd probably just run three. The fewer you can run, the better. There's guys that make it work with three nails in the rocky country. I put four in, it's all personal preference. Are you done snorting it, whatever you're snorting with? Huh? Okay. This is a trick I just learned and I kind of liked it. That's just regular old Vaseline. Got a box of shoe and nails. There's several different sizes of shoe and nails. I use CH5s. They're small enough to work with easily, and they're strong enough that they don't break or come apart. Ollie, he's fine. Pick old Luke's foot up here. Make sure it's clean. I'll get that shoe right exactly where I want it. Take one of my nails, dip it in the Vaseline. And when you put your nail in, if you want to get real close on that, hun. When you put your nail in, you need to get it centered in the hole the best you can. Because as it goes in, if it's pushed to the outside of the hole, it'll push the whole shoe to the outside. Okay, get that set. Bend the point of the nail off and break it off. I just slap it on the magnet of my shoes, or my shaft rather. That Vaseline on the nail just helps the nails drive in a bit easier. transfers less force to the horse. So I'll get two nails in. I usually, 99% of the time, start with the same two nails on either side. And then I'll set his foot down, and I'll walk around him and make sure that I'm happy with how it's sitting. I don't have a bunch hanging out the back of his foot there. It's even. It's the shoe's not crooked relative to his foot. And there's nothing weird going on up front here. Pretty straightforward. Then I'll pick his foot back up. And I'll set the rest of my nails. With young horses, or maybe horses that are sore on another leg or something like that, I'll only put in two nails at a time and I'll give them a break. Or if I'm out of shape at the time or whatever, you know, that happens. Your horseshoe nails are shaped. They're not symmetrical front to back. And the important thing with those is to always put the flat side of the horseshoe nail to the outside, and what that causes is the nail to curve to the outside of the foot and come out through the hoof wall rather than going deeper into the foot or the hoof and causing injury. As far as getting a real nice, straight, pretty nail line, the only two things I have to say about that is point your nail where you want it to come out and drive a couple thousand of them and you'll get it figured out. I don't always have the best nail lines, but I'm not in any shows. I'd rather my shoes stay on. If you notice, I'll hit it a couple times and then pause for just a half a second or so. All I'm doing is checking and making sure that that nail has come out of the foot, out of the side of the hoof wall where I wanted it to. You know, not too low, because it would pull out and you'd lose the shoe. And obviously if it doesn't come out, it could make him real sore. It's called hot nailing one. So you can see here, I've got about a finger's width between the bottom of the foot and the majority of my nails. This one's a hair high, but not bad. That's pretty good right there. If one wants to keep coming lower, I'll try it a second time. If it still wants to come right there, then I just deal with it. It's better than putting a whole bunch of holes through his foot. You have to kind of think of the integrity of the horse's foot, because you essentially are putting holes in it. I will do that much all the way around, all 4 feet, and then come back and finish him. But just for the continuity of the video, I'll finish this one right now, and then I'll do the other three when I shut the camera off. Finishing them is pretty straightforward. I will grab my old rasp, which they both look old, but this one's older. I don't use a shoeing stand very often. And all I'm doing is going right below the nail with my rasp and just knocking off any mud, dirt, hoof wall that flakes off easily, something like that. Not some people want to say you're digging grooves or whatever, and maybe the right way to do it is to do that. I don't. Okay, these are called clinchers, and they bend the point that we nipped off. They bend it over to the outside of the hoof wall, which will hold the nail on. And they, pretty simple, the bottom part sits on the head of the nail and the top part just grabs it and bends it, clinches it. These clinchers are actually draft horse clinchers. But they're the ones I learned with, so they're the ones I use. my clinches might be better if I had a real set of clinchers, or they might not. So when I get to the inside, he's not wanting to hold that foot up very good. I can grab it and hold it the other way. And clinch him this way. Brinley, hey. She's mad at me because I'm not paying attention to her. Okay, nails are clenched. We'll grab my nippers again. Set his foot up here, and I'm just gonna go right around with the bottom jaw of my nipper. I'll just touch the shoe and I'm just nipping off that excess that we talked about a minute ago. Luke's got good feet. I'm not gonna go all the way around, but I just want to get the majority of it right now, because I'll come back with my rasp. And clean it up with my rasp. Okay, biggest thing I'm doing. What is your issue, Luke? He's normally really good. Probably because my wife's standing in front of him with the camera. He doesn't like change. But as I was saying, the biggest thing I'm doing is ensuring that there's no hoof hanging out over the edge of the shoe, because that would chip. I'll grab it the other way again and just finish cleaning it up right there. You stubborn old man. Okay, I got quite a bit of excess right there, but that's kind of flared out, which is why I didn't shape the shoe over top of it, because I wanted to clean that up and bring that flare back in. Okay, looks good. A little bit right here I want to address. Okay. Looking good. The very last thing I'll do is I'll grab his foot the other way yet again. Mustang, come on. And I'll just take each one of those clinches and barely go over top of them. That way, if there's any burrs from the clinchers, I've knocked them smooth. And that foot's done. You're fine. So, I'm gonna let my wife get back to the baby. That way she'll quit tormenting Luke up here. But that's how I go about shoeing one. Again, I'm not a farrier. That's not a how-to. That's just how I do it. So thanks for hanging out while we put one shoe on him. I'll do the other three here in a minute. And then this Friday, make sure and keep an eye out for our third day up at the Knot Creek Ranch. We'll see you guys later.